welcome back to the circuit of Barcelona, Catalonia, where we have had a sun-soaked Grand Prix here today, full of drama, unexpected drama you could only begin to imagine. But to start us off with, we need to talk about the winner here today, Fabio Quartararo, in an absolute league of his own, Lewis. I'm joined by Lewis Sedeby, one of your MotoGP commentators. Lewis, I mean, before we start to digest some of the things we saw out there on track today, we do need to give a nod to Fabio Quartararo. It was an important weekend for him, starting off with the news that he had re-signed with Yamaha. He got the job done yesterday in qualifying to take a win here. He said it himself, these two last races were meant to be tricky races for him.
They were supposed to be tricky races. He feared with the long straights of Mugello and Catalunya that he might have to play damage limitation over these two weekends. He actually spoke on Friday and said that if the Grand Prix had taken place then, he would have been limiting the damage. That Yamaha wasn't working particularly well for him on Friday, but he comes away from this doubleheader with 45 points from a possible 50. And as you mentioned, a dramatic Grand Prix elsewhere. Fabio Quartararo couldn't really, when he woke up this morning, have scripted a better Grand Prix than that. A dominant victory for him in the end. The start was crucial for Fabio Quartararo. He took the lead at the start. This is him pulling away from his rivals at the front. That crucial move up the inside of Aleix Espargaró into turn one at the start of the Grand Prix was really where Fabio Quartararo's race was made, because Aleix Espargaró just simply could not match his pace.
He made a really, really lucky escape early on. And that brings us on to the first piece of drama we saw out on track today. Takaaki Nakagami unfortunately losing the front, and in doing so, took out Pecco Bagnaia and Alex Rins. It was a horrible, horrible moment for Alex Rins. We really do hope that he's okay. Obviously, we will bring you some news on that if we do get any during this show. But Lewis, I mean, I don't know how you guys didn't keep it more together in the commentary box, because it was shocking.
It's really shocking. A real, real shame for Takaaki Nakagami. We hope he's okay, and Alex Rins, of course, following that collision. And it's had a real bearing on the World Championship, of course, with Pecco Bagnaia losing crucial points. He's now 66 points adrift in the battle for the World Championship. So it's got a huge bearing on the World Championship that instant. But yeah, we hope that Takaaki Nakagami and Alex Rins are okay. A nasty, nasty collision. Nakagami's had one or two incidents in recent races. He certainly wasn't Alex Rins' best friend following the Italian Grand Prix at Mugello. That relationship certainly won't have improved. But yeah, we hope they're all okay, but no points for two of the key contenders who we expected to fight for the podium.
Well, we're ready now to head on over to Matt Burt, who has our first podium finisher ready and ready to speak to him. Jorge Martin, fantastic to see him back on the podium. P2 today and fighting back from what's been a bit more of a trickier start to 2022 than anticipated.
Yeah, thanks, Amy. Jorge Martin, proof that you can't keep a good man down for too long. Jorge, you've had to wait a while for this podium. It was a difficult one in a very demanding race, hot physically, tough mentally as well. But let's go all the way back to the start, because I think you were quite fortunate to miss all that chaos with Nakagami, Bagnaia and Rins going down at turn one.
Yeah, I was really fast into the first part of the start. I overtook Fabio Di Antonio, and also with Johan, I could catch him. And I was close to him trying to overtake. Then Nakagami passed me super fast, and for sure I thought about some disaster. And yeah, he lost the front. He crashed into the first corner. I was lucky to avoid it. I saw Pecco crash, and then it was difficult to get the concentration back. But yeah, finally, I was really constant, tried to manage the tire. I tried to be in front of Aleix and make a little bit gap for keeping the front tire in a good temperature. But then he was fighting back, and yeah, it was a nice fight. And for sure, being on the podium for me after a 1 month, really, really tough. With a lot of people talking, and you know, it's not easy to be fully focused. But today I demonstrated that I am the same Martinator, just with the same bike at the beginning of the year. And I'm confident for the next races, because finally this bike is working. I think we touched one click during all the weekend, and yeah, this is the main thing. So really happy. It's my bike. It's my confidence coming back. So I hope to be competitive also in Germany.
Before we talk about what happened on the last lap as well with Aleix, what has changed this weekend? I mean, what has been the feeling that's come back to you that you had at the start of the season?
Just the front. I can go into the corners, slide the rear. If you see the photos from 2 weeks ago, I couldn't even slide. I felt nothing in the front. Just going into the corner and trying not to crash, and riding like this is impossible. Today I was riding to try to make everything out of the track, trying to give my 100% and feeling the front. At least I felt some moments, but at least I feel them, no? In the last races I just crashed. So I'm happy, the team is really happy, and we are really, really together now, and I feel like a big family in Pramac, so I hope we can, from here, start building a great results.
It was a dramatic start to the race and an even more dramatic finish. I mean, what was going through your mind when you came over the line and you saw Alesi pull up? I mean, everybody thought he had a mechanical problem, but...
Yeah, me too. Yeah, for sure, I thought he had a mechanical problem. He was pushing a lot the last two laps, so I thanks to that, I could make a gap with Johan. I was even catching him because he destroyed the rear tire, and I thought about a move in the last lap, but then I thought he broke the engine. I even closed on the straight, trying not to broke my engine, and yeah, the last lap I was just trying to finish because I thought I was going to broke the engine. But yeah, it's a pity for him because he's come race with a lot of fans here. He did an amazing job during all the weekend. But yeah, for sure, he's strong everywhere.
The Martinator is definitely back. Great job today, Jorge.
Thank you.
Best of luck as well with the surgery on the nerve tomorrow.
Thank you very much. I will be back really good in Germany.
Great job.
Okay, thank you, mate.
Well, it's great to hear from Jorge Martin. Switching over to those Olin Sports, seems to really have made a massive, massive difference for Jorge. But just before we crossed over to Matt Lewis, we were talking about the high drama at the start involving Takaaki Nakagami, Alex Rins and Pecco Bagnaia. I do believe that we're about to get some footage of that in just a second. But before we bring you those images, let's just talk a little bit about Jorge Martin and his return to form. It's just funny how like such small, simple thing. I mean, it's not small, it's the front end of your bike. So we know that it leads to massive confidence, but it's great to have him back.
But one change to that motorcycle has transformed his fortunes. Of course, he was on the front row of the grid in the first four Grand Prix. What he wasn't doing was translating that potential into points. He was not seeing enough checkered flags, really, was he, in 2022 so far? But he's got that old feeling back now. He's able now to break as late as the likes of Bagnaia and Bastianini, who've been doing the winning so far this year for Ducati so far. So Jorge Martin, much more like his old self. And as you heard there from Matt just at the end of the interview, he is going under the surgeon's knife tomorrow for surgery on his hand. He's been having issues with that in the last few Grand Prix, basically ever since his crash at Portimao last year. He's been having issues in the closing stages of the race where his hand's been going to sleep. That now will be a thing of the past. So we look forward to Jorge Martin fighting fit and back at his best for the Grand Prix going forward.
Well, we have been singing his praises at the start of the show. Fabio Quartararo in an absolute league of his own today. It looked absolutely effortless from the defending world champion. Let's cross now and speak to Fabio.
Yeah, thanks, Amy. I am with the reigning world champion, a man who sits at the top of the world championship for a very good reason, because Fabio, that was an astonishing ride today. It looked like from the outside one of the best of your career after Mugello last weekend. But how crucial was the start and that first corner where you got up the inside of both Pecco Bagnaia and Aleix Espargaró, because that seemed to be the platform for the win?
Yes, I wanted to be first in the first corner. And when I brake that late in the first corner, I said, I'm not going to turn. But I braked super hard and confidence was there. And it was a long race because I was first from the first corner to the end. And I think I was riding my best. Every weekend, I feel I'm riding better on the bike, understanding much more how to be fast and consistent. So I feel like a rider, I'm improving so much.
Coming into this week, everybody thought it was going to be very, very difficult for you and for Yamaha. Mugello with a long straight, Barcelona with a long straight, but you leave 45 points out of 50. What can you say about that? I mean, it's been an incredible week.
I say it's almost perfect. It's almost perfect, but I didn't expect to win here. Today I felt I could win, but Friday I say if I make a top 10 will be good. Not top 10, but top 5 will be great. And Saturday was much better. I felt like I had one of the strongest pace. This morning with really used tire, I was fast. And on the race, I was just feeling amazing. I was, controlling myself even in the beginning when I had 1 second lead. I said, okay, I'm going faster, and was much better.
This was potentially a significant day in the championship because unfortunately, Pecco was involved in the incident at the first corner, and now Bastianini crashed out at turn 5. And then, of course, Aleix made the big mistake at the end of the Grand Prix. So in terms of the championship, this was a fantastic day for you, wasn't it?
Yes, a fantastic day. And you know that for me, it's super special. Today, I achieved my 10th win in MotoGP, something super special because as a kid, I was dreaming about to be MotoGP rider, and today I achieved my 10th win. So
I think we are on a really good way for the future.
The weekend started brilliantly with the new contract with Yamaha, and I wasn't sure if I was in Le Mans or in Barcelona with the podium. I mean, the noise coming from the crowd was incredible. That must have been a pretty special feeling as well.
Yes, and you know, I just came back with no boots, no gloves. I mean, was more French than Spanish people. Even if I like Spanish fans, was great to see all the French people listening the anthem of France on the podium. Was something super special.
Another amazing job today, Fabio. Many congratulations. We'll see you in Germany in 2 weeks.
Thank you.
Lovely to hear the thoughts there of Fabio Quartararo and that moment he was talking about launching his gloves, boots, everything he had on him. And I was actually really privileged to witness that down in Parc Fermé. And the reception he got, the noise from the fans here was thundering.
It was reminiscent of the scenes before the Grand Prix in Le Mans, where we had that rousing rendition of La Marseillaise as Fabio Quartararo sat on the grid looking to challenge for home Grand Prix glory. It's probably closer as the crow flies this circuit to his home in Nice than his home Grand Prix at Le Mans. So you can understand why a lot of French fans have crossed the border and come out here. But his performance today was every bit as good as what we saw in Mugello. On this show last weekend, Simon Crafar described his second place at Mugello as the best single riding performance of the season so far. His performance today was right up there. He was absolutely incredible. He was able to consistently lap in the 1 minute 40s for way longer than anybody else. There was no signs of any real tyre drop for him in the end of the Grand Prix. And as we mentioned earlier on in the show, with the way the championship has played out today, he suddenly got a real grip on this world championship. Aleix Espargaró is still within 22 points of him, but his Ducati rivals have lost an awful lot of ground today. So it's difficult to have scripted a better race for Fabio.
Well, we're going to head back down now to speak to Matt Burt, because he's with our final podium man. Perhaps an unexpected podium for Johann Zarco, but he had to work hard over the course of the weekend when things didn't perhaps start off in the best manner on Friday. But let's hear his thoughts now.
Thanks, Amy. Yes, I am with third place man here in Barcelona, Johann Zarco. Johann, I don't really know where to start, because there was drama at the start, the incident involving Nakagami, Bagnaia and Rins, which I think you were very, very close to, and then drama at the end of the race as well, getting on the podium after the unfortunate mistake of Aleix Espargaró. So it was a pretty eventful start and finish to this Grand Prix for you.
That's the advantage to keep believing and do not give up during the race. From the start, yeah, this first corner, I saw Nakagami coming pretty fast, and when he crashed, I was happy just to go between the bikes there. Paul started well, but I was faster than him, so I could overtake him immediately. And then I was in fourth position, and I really tried to stay behind Aleix and Martin. At the beginning, I was missing a bit of speed. Fabio was much faster and went away. But I was the only one with the hard rear tire, so I expected to get an advantage during the race, and I tried to control my rear tire. I was not spinning a lot. I was really, really trying to handle well. And but at the 10 laps to the end, and even 5 laps to the end, I didn't get the advantage, and was even the opposite. I was losing even more in acceleration. So then, when I understood I cannot fight for the podium, I was frustrated a lot. That it's a place I can't feel good. I have a different strategy of the other, and I cannot catch the advantage. So that was hard to finish the race not on the podium, but a nice gift on the last lap. I thought a technical problem from Aleix, and when I understood he was celebrating, wow, I tried to catch my focus back and finish my lap. So podium with the teammate is fantastic for the team, and nice victory from Fabio. That was great to enjoy this moment, live this victory of a French guy in life again, and sing the French item and enjoy with the fan.
How difficult was it to quickly regain your focus after Aleix's mistake? Because you think he's got the mechanical, then you realise he's celebrating too early. So I mean, you've got to then quickly get your head down, because you're fighting for the podium. It can't have been easy.
No, it's not easy. Then I tried to, because I don't know how quick he restart or not, and because he was strong at the end, I hope that he will not overtake me again. And I tried to close the line, but I was spinning so much, and seeing also Martin keep pushing, then I understood quickly, no, I still have one lap to do. So was kind of okay. great surprise, just finish it.
And we just spoke to Fabio. It was almost felt like after the race, with all the fans on the grid and under the podium, it was like we were in Le Mans, not in Barcelona. I mean, you guys got a great reception from the French fans who come over the border. I mean, that must have been a pretty special feeling as well, not just to stand on the podium with Fabio, but to see all the French fans enjoying that moment with you guys.
Catalonia is the second French Grand Prix, or the South French Grand Prix, we can say, because all the South of France is coming here. For them, it's even better than Le Mans, because Barcelona, it's a nice city to party in the evening and then have a nice Grand Prix on the Sunday. So there, many are coming to have a nice Spanish weekend with a French victory and two French on the podium. I think they will start the work on Monday pretty happy.
Well, let's hope those French fans do party in Barcelona tonight, and you get to celebrate as well, despite the fact that you're testing tomorrow. Great job today, Joan.
See you.
Well, lovely to see the smile back on Johan Zarco's face again. It might be unexpected, but a podium is a podium. And he said, you know, the hard rear tire wasn't actually as much of an advantage as he thought it would be.
No, that was the question we asked going into the Grand Prix. Johan Zarco was the one rider in that leading group of four who'd gone for the harder rear tire. As you say, it didn't have that advantage at the end, but a good result for Johan Zarco. He goes well around here. He was very, very close to the race victory here 1 year ago, finished right on the tail of Miguel Oliveira in his second podium of the season. Of course, his other podium here he shared with Fabio Quartararo as well. But as you mentioned, we're very, very close to the south of France here in Barcelona. So it had a real French flavour to it on the podium there. The rendition of La Marseillaise, which out of picture, Johan Zarco was conducting on the podium. So a memorable afternoon for Johan Zarco, and a great day for Pramac Ducati, of course, after announcing their brand new title sponsor, second and third for them.
Well, we've of course now heard both Jorge Martin and Johan Zarco reference the fact that there was absolute heartbreak for one man. He was the home hero of the weekend. It was set to be the most perfect home Grand Prix of Aleix Espargaró's history, but unfortunately a human error on the final lap, celebrating too early. Lewis, there's been various theories thrown around as to what went on. Obviously we learned very, very soon on that it wasn't a mechanical and it had actually been human error, but just, I mean, it's hard to watch this right now.
Really is. He was inconsolable when he came back into the Aprilia box. This was him after crossing the line. You can see how gutted he is. Of course, a human error, as you say. When a rider crashes out of a Grand Prix, that kind of thing can happen. But when you make a human mistake like that, miscounting the laps, that is going to linger for a long time for Aleix Espargaró. The only person that ultimately will be able to tell us what happened there was Aleix Espargaró himself. We were trying to go back through the footage and try and work out whether the scoreboard on the right-hand side, the rider's right, was wrong. It was actually wrong. It said there were two laps to go rather than one. So it's not as if Aleix Espargaró thought the race was already finished. So Aleix Espargaró making a crucial mistake cost him 9 world championship points. He dropped from second to fifth in the end. And who knows how crucial those points are going to be at the end of the season. He is the leading contender to Fabio Quartararo. With the Ducati riders losing points today, Aleix Espargaró is the only rider within touching distance of Quartararo in the championship. So those points could be crucial. But you saw the Aprilia team rallying around. You saw Dorna Sports CEO Carmelo Ezpeleta rallying around and consoling Aleix Espargaró. He is having the season of his life, and he was on target. He was one lap away from another podium finish in second place. So Aleix Espargaró, for 90% of that Grand Prix, was faultless, but that mistake will really linger for a long time. It cost him dearly.
Well, let's hope that he can bounce back next time out in Germany and continue this magnificent form we've been seeing him in and enjoying to see him and Aprilia in so far this season. But it wasn't just a hit for him in terms of the championship standings. Pecco Bagnaia, as we keep mentioning, this high drama at the start, which I think we're going to have a quick look at now. Unfortunately, he had a bit of a mountain to climb when it came to the championship standings, having got his season underway really a little bit later than he would have liked. But here are the images, Lewis.
Here's a look at the start then. So you've got Pecco Bagnaia on the right-hand side as you look. Nakagami's now in fourth position. He'll lose the front. Alex Rins has got nowhere to go, so he tags the back of Bagnaia. He actually hits his face on the back of that Ducati, so we hope that Takaki Nakagami is okay. Here's another look at it from slow motion. He loses the front. You can see there he makes contact with the rear tire of the Ducati, and Alex Rins absolutely launched through the air. We saw Alex Rins sat in the Suzuki box later on after the Grand Prix, so he was just about okay, of course, given the circumstances. He'll obviously be in a little bit of pain. But yeah, it's cost Pekka Bagnaia crucial points. He just can't get his season up and running, can he? That's two Grand Prix victories he's taken now, which he's followed with crashes out of a race. And as mentioned, two Grand Prix victories for him, 50 points. But with those back-to-back DNFs that have followed each of the victories, 66 points now behind Fabio Quartararo. There's still an awful long way to go in this World Championship. But at this stage of the season, that's an awful lot of points for Pekka Bagnaia to try and make up, with Fabio Quartararo looking near faultless.
There was actually quite a high rate of attrition out there today. Both Gresini riders, unfortunately, in the matter of one lap, went down. And fortunately, Nea Bastianini, who also is in contention of this championship and was trying to bounce back, actually, from a bit of a difficult Mugello race. And then Fabio Di Antonio, who's following up from a real dream home race in Mugello just one weekend ago, unfortunately also found himself in the gravel.
Yeah, real shame for Gresini. Ducati, so much potential for them this weekend. You just saw the beginning of Fabio Di Antonio's crash there. A real shame for Enea Bastianini. We discussed him last weekend on After the Flag with Simon Crafar, that we sometimes forget that Enea Bastianini is only in his second season in MotoGP. He's set the bar so high with his victories so far this season, three Grand Prix victories. And we thought that today was going to be right up his street with the tyre management race that we're expecting, trying to keep some grip towards the end of the race. And we've seen this on a few occasions now this season with Enea Bastianini. The mistakes tend to happen from him when he's coming from deep on the grid. When he starts outside the top 10, as he was in Portimao, he crashed trying to come through the field. He crashed trying to come through from 10th in Mugello. And then again today, 14th on the grid, and a mistake trying to make his way through the field. So when it goes right for Bastianini, he can challenge for wins. But on his bad days, he's not limiting the damage.
Well, it was a difficult time out for one of the Suzuki riders, Alex Rins. But on the other half, Joan Mir made great progress at the start. I think he believed did he go up from 17th to 7th? In one lap. Impressive stuff. We know that he is looking to get his season back on track. But do you think he'll be happy and walk away with the result today and be able to build on that momentum? Because we have been wondering whether the whole Suzuki departing the paddock at the end of this season is perhaps starting to interfere a little bit with how his kind of race mentality and everything is working over the weekend.
As a human being, that has to distract him somewhat. The upheaval, the off-camera headlines that have been made at Suzuki, we don't need to go into that. Everyone knows what's going on off track with Suzuki. But Joan Mir, that'll be a huge boost to his confidence today. On Friday, I don't think I'd ever seen him as downcast as he was when he was sat in the pit box in Suzuki, having finished the day in, I think he was 17th on Friday, qualified down in 17th on the grid. But proof of the class that Joan Mir's got. That first lap, of course, there was incidents ahead of him which he took advantage of, but you've got to be there to capitalise on that. And of course, the final lap, brain fade, if you like, from Aleix Espargaró certainly boosted Joan Mir. So let's hope that's the start of a Joan Mir revival. He hasn't really had a dip since winning that MotoGP World Championship in 2020. He's been so faultless. He's one of the elite riders in MotoGP. So hopefully that's him back in business now.
Well, that's all from us here at round 9 of the MotoGP World Championship. And what a race it was. We're getting ready now to head to our press conference with our podium men today and Matt Burt.
The MotoGP race here in Catalonia is going. It's a great launch from pole position by Aprilia's Aleix Espargaró. He made the dream start. Fabio Quartararo likewise has got already through on Pekka Bagnaia, and Quartararo goes
in. Oh,
Quartararo has been whacked. Oh. Alex Rins of Pekka Bagnaia, sorry, has been taken out. As Martin gets up the inside of Aleix Espargaró in the braking zone for the first corner, he's stuck in a prima prima Ducati sandwich right now.
Somebody's gone down.
Bastianini's gone down again. Well, can you believe it? Ducati's World Championship challenge is evaporating rapidly here.
As Aleix Espargaró now pulls out of the slipstream, he is up the inside this time. Can he get that Aprilia stopped into turn one? He can. One lap away from the completion of another Quartararo masterclass.
Aleix Espargaró's got a problem. Can you believe this? On the last lap, does he think the race is finished? I think he thinks it's
realized.
Over. Oh my goodness, can you believe it? What a howler by Aleix Espargaró. Quartararo conquers the Catalan Grand Prix. A truly dominant performance by the reigning world champion.
Jorge Martin will take second place. It's going to be two Prima Prima Ducatis on the podium in the most bizarre circumstances. An absolute gift for two Frenchmen.